studies, the beginning of your studies in the United States, when you left the army after 5 years in Israel.
Right. I came to Chicago, and I enrolled at IIT, and I got there my BSc. And after I finished my BSc, I had received a fellowship from Washington, D.C. for a PhD, for a doctor, immediately. In other words, even that.
What did you major in?
I majored in engineering sciences. Engineering science. So I've received a fellowship for a doctorate, even though I didn't have my master's yet, my second degree yet. So anyway, I was working full time and going to school full time all the time because I had a family. So I got my BSc, I received my master's, and then I went to USC and got my doctorate. And then I was, since I was working anyway, full time at that time, and when I was getting my doctorate at USC, I was doing work for North American Aviation, who was working for NASA on the space project. So what happened is that I got special project from NASA, personal projects to do while doing work for the North American Aviation. In other words, North American got project from NASA on my name directly. And I was pretty active in the space project. At that time, what happened is, since I mentioned Apollo 13, which is now famous, at that time it was not relevant to us, because when Apollo 13 happened, the accident happened, I was called to Houston, Texas. NASA collected about 12 people, 12 scientists from the United States, all over the United States, to try to get these people down. And I was involved in that. We worked three days and nights to figure out what happened there and how can bring them down. It just so happened that I disagreed with the other colleagues of mine on what happened, and we had arguments and disagreements. And the producers of the what happened there is that the oxygen tank blew up. The producers was Beech Aircraft, produced the tank of steel, oxygen tank, which blew up. They argued with me that what I'm suggesting that happened, maybe it's not true, maybe. To cut it short, NASA, at night, last night, they did an experiment. Who was right? It just so happens, Bezrat Hashem, that I was right. So I was congratulated, and they said, NASA said, we're going to give you, from now on, project, you are our man. You want a job here, we'll get a job here. Anyway, but that was after we brought him down, because after this work, we brought the people down, and then I got all kinds of offers from Beechcraft that I should take over their things. And that was, I stayed there another number of years, and that was it. Eventually, I came back.
When did you come back to Israel?
I came exactly when my second son was being bar mitzvah, for his bar mitzvah, and we came back here. Of course, I had some property here too, which was left to me by my mother, that she bought in 1928, I believe, 29, something like that. A piece of land, which is now the center the center of the town of the city of Rishon LeZion. So we built something on that too, Baruch Hashem.
Dr. Petter, I would like to ask you if there is anything else you would like to add to this interview. there anything else you want to say to the future generation of your own family and for all of us?
Whatever I say to the future generation, I don't think it's going to be relevant, because at least in my experience and opinion, they don't listen to us. See, we are the older generation. We don't know. Our experiences don't jive with their experiences. So they'll respect what I said, but they will not consider it relevant to their lives. So what should we say? We only can say that God should help, that whatever they do should be for the best. That's all I can say.
Is there anything else you would like to add? Any lesson that we should learn from the Holocaust, in your opinion, message that you have to say?
There is the only lesson that you can learn from the Holocaust is that people are made by what they go through. And there is no way that anybody can imagine or ever know what it means to go through the Holocaust. One of the reasons I haven't talked about the Holocaust for years, I refuse to talk about it, and I still try not to talk about it. This interview I'm giving here is for the future generation, for the sake of my family, basically, and that's important to me. But otherwise, there is no way that anybody can know what it is. Just like, let's ask, who can measure human suffering? I'm asking a question, simple question. Is there a gauge by which you can measure when a person suffers? Is there a gauge that can measure the pain and the suffering of a child that lost his father? Can you measure it by a gauge? Can you measure human suffering? No ways. You cannot do that. Some people go through hell while being alive. And there is no measure to do that, to appreciate that. Impossible. You can talk about it, and you can evoke sympathy. Boy, that's real bad. You went through all that. But the measure of suffering is not for us to measure and to know. So what can we say about a generation that went through hell and knew every day what hell was, every day, every minute? Can you measure? Is there a gauge to measure it? No. Is there any way to translate it and to make the future generation aware of the feeling? No, they cannot, no ways. As I said before, they'll listen to it, they'll evoke sympathy and maybe tears and cries, but to know and to take heed, I don't think that they'll do it. In my experience, at least, they don't. They say, yeah, this is fine, it's all true, and we sympathize, and we know how much, but it's not for us. We are a different generation, we live our lives. So I say again, God should help, that they have the sense to somehow or other realize what's right, what's wrong. That's all I can say.
Thank you very much for giving your testimony. Who is this in the picture?
This is my father, my brother, and myself, right here.
On the right?
On my right.
Yes.
On my father's right is my brother. On my father's left is myself.
Where was this picture taken?
That was taken at a at a summer resort in 1934, I believe. 1934, 33, something like that.
How did you manage to save it?
I did not. I did not save it. That picture I received from family of mine who were never in the Holocaust. They lived with us. The cousin I was talking about, who lived on Radwańska in Poland, in Lodz. Then they moved to Palestine then, and they took some pictures with them. That's how I got it.
Who's this?
This is my mother, Aleha Shalom. This picture is taken in Germany.
In what year?
I would say around 1964, 65. She went to Germany in order to claim reparations for all the machinery and the materials that the Germans stole from us, from the factory of my father. And that's when she took that picture.
When did your mother pass away?
She passed away in 1972. Aleha Shalom.
Where?
In Israel.
Who is this?
This is my aunt. Her name is Fela, and she was one of my father's sisters who was not in the Holocaust. She moved to Egypt before the war and stayed there, and she never knew about the Holocaust. So about the only picture I have from her is that. I do not have the pictures of the other aunts who did not survive the Holocaust. They were killed in Warsaw Ghetto.
When was this picture taken?
This picture was taken in 1932, 1933.
And how did you manage having it? How did you save it? Did you have it with you?
I received also from my family. I got it. There's no pictures I've saved myself because there was no way that I could have done it. Everything I have from the family, from before the war is only from my family that were here, and they had that.
Please explain to us those pictures.
Yes. These pictures are from the time when I was in the Air Force, Chel Avir Israeli, and that was around 1952, and it depicts basically the planes we were working on and the work we were doing and the fun we were having. This is just a fun picture with my friend. Oh. The picture on the left is a fun picture with my friend. The right-hand picture is one of the planes we're working on to make it serviceable, to fly. That's about it.
When did you get married?
We got married in 1951. And that was after I was sent to the States by the Air Force. And didn't finish my BSc, but I did get something out of it anyway, because I met Marilyn, who became my wife. She was also in Tulsa, Oklahoma at that time. And we met at that time, and of course we, for whatever reason, we did not marry in the States, because I thought and she thought that it's better to do it here in Israel. I was at that time already in the first years of my Air Force service, so she was kind enough to come here to Tel Aviv, and here we got together again and we married, and that was in 1951, which means that I am living with my dear wife from 51, which is until now, which is 46, almost 47 years.
What is this?
This is among the many functions that I had to do in the Air Force. One of my functions was to set up a technical school, or part of a school basically, talking about hydraulic parts of airplanes in the Beit Sefer Techni Bet Shel Chel Avir, which is in Haifa. So when I finish this portion of my service to the Air Force, I was kindly given this symbol as a hokara for what I did at that time.
Okay. What is this?
This is an Apollo Achievement Award, which I received from NASA for my contribution to the space project. And also on what I did on the Apollo 13, which, as I mentioned before, at that time we didn't know we did anything special, but since Apollo 13, since that time, became so famous, so I guess that that was one of the things that we had to mention here. Also, on the bottom you can see the medal that was given to me, made from the metal. This is a medal which was made from the metal of Apollo, which came back. Not 13, I believe it's a different number. I don't remember this one. Which means the body of the Apollo, which was made of metal, that's the medallion, or the medal, is being given to me in appreciation for the work I've done for them.
This is the other side of the coin.
I'll have to look at it. I don't remember.
Who is your wife from all of these people?
This is my dear wife, Marilyn. And this is my dear daughter, Orly Joe. This is my son, Yaakov Pinchas. This is his son, Daniel Yitzchak. And this is my daughter's...
We'll first introduce the other daughter.
Yes.
And this is my daughter, Tamar Yona. And her children are Kalman Shlomo. Start from the oldest one. Fine, I'll do that. Start from the oldest one, which is Ayala Helena, named after my mother. And the next one is Yitzchak, which is named after his father's father. Grandfather. And the next one is Ephraim Menashe Yosef, who is named after your grandfather. And then the next one is Kalman Shlomo, who is named after my father, Lava Shalom. The next one is Levi Yecheskel, who is named the name Yecheskel after this cousin that I was speaking about beforehand. Okay, the next one we have Yaakov Pinchas, I mentioned already, his son is Daniel Yitzchak. Now we've got my son here is Aryeh Ishaya. That's my son.
After
His two children.
After your uncle Leon.
He's named after my uncle Leon, which is Aryeh. And he has got two children, Tila Rivka and Atara Veret, who aren't here right now, and his wife is also not here. And this is Inga. This is Yaakov's wife, and she's the mother of Daniel Yitzchak. And this is Harav David, is the father of these kids here, which I just introduced to everybody.
And there's one son that is not here?
And
Billy.
My oldest son is in the States right now. He's not here. And he has got two children. One of them is Yonatan. And the other one is David. That's their name.
See his picture. This is him up here. If you can get it.
How many grandchildren do you have?
13 grandchildren, Sheikh Hugh.
I'm referring the question to the children. Is there anything you want to ask your father in the end of the interview?
I'm Orly, my father's first daughter. I would like to ask you, I thought Shlomit did an excellent job of bringing out a lot of material that I've never heard, and definitely have never heard it from beginning to end. I thought you did a wonderful job. At the end, though, one of the things she asked you in summation was to draw some sort of conclusion that you could pass on to your future generations. And you didn't want to do it at that time because you thought they won't listen. And I would like to ask you again Shlomit's question, if you could please do that for us. One of the things you and I have been talking about is we can't predict the future. And certainly, I think it's good for you to talk, whoever listens. So could you please do that?
Well, I was asked the question before, as you mentioned, and I answered the question because it's very, very hard to tell somebody else, especially future generation, what can they learn from the Holocaust or from my experiences, because like they say, which I heard before from my offspring, your experiences may be very important, but they're not quite relevant to what's happening today. Our experiences, we're living in a different world. That's not the same world.
Well, can you say what you learned?
I learned that there are times in one's life when you have to forget about what you want and think about what's best for other people who you are very, very close to. Like my father, give you an example, my father refused to, he could have saved his life very easily. He had all the money to pay for whatever, for his rescue. Mm-hmm. And he could have certainly said, you know what, I'm going to go, and then I'll try to get you out. At least one will get out of the hell. But he hasn't done that. He stayed with us, mm-hmm. and he paid with his life for that. Mm-hmm. My mother sacrificed herself for us too by putting her life on the edge every time she took something out of the kitchen in order to sustain us and her husband. If she was caught taking her, even though it was supposedly her rations, because the reasoning was like that. She is getting her rations in the kitchen when she works there. But now she takes her rations and gives it away. They know that she eats anyway. Where does she eat? In the place where she works, in the kitchen. Mm-hmm. So indirectly she got her rations, and now this is plain stealing. It's taken away. Mm-hmm. So certainly she would lose her life. So in other words, it's not sometimes you figure, yes, I'm in a very bad situation. I suffer, but let's consider. Maybe I should sacrifice, and I think that sacrifice is what makes people. If we look at real big people, mm-hmm. in history, our history or whatever, in the history of every nation or every family. I think that sacrifice is what makes them, in a way, whichever way they make it. It's not people that don't sacrifice are not the people that you can say are really great because they do what's necessary. That's about it.
My name is Yaakov,
and
I wanted to shortly, I heard most of it, but I just wanted to ask two questions. Number one, you mentioned once how you would steal apples.
Yes.
And you would smuggle them into the ghetto?
Not exactly. What happened is our factory was near a garden. That garden, they grew apples and tomatoes and cucumbers. Whatever was possible to grow was being grown for the sake of the German people that come to see the head of the factory. Berenstein was his name. So they were growing it for them and for themselves, for him, and for the whatever Germans that were there. They allowed this garden. Usually they didn't allow us to grow anything. So it really hurt me, not only hurt me, but I was hungry. But when I saw the full baskets of fruit being taken from there to the house of the head of the factory, Bernstein, and they were lying there until a German came and until some other personality came from the ghetto administration, and some of them really spoiling. So what we did, I and a friend of mine, we decided that we also have a family. Not only the head of the factory has a family. And I have also a family. I have a sick father at home at that time. So we waited until, usually we waited, we went home around 9 o'clock in the, at night. So just before we went home, we opened, we dug under the fence of the garden. And we stole into the garden, and I put apples, sometimes cucumber, one cucumber, mostly apples, I used to wear knickers, what they call it, that were closed here. And here I had my socks. So I used to put apples which were hanging down here. It was all filled with apples. And the problem I had is that when I was leaving, as I said before, every factory was guarded by one person, day and night. He was sitting in a booth, guard booth, just to watch. My father, when he was still, he was also doing that. And the problem I had is when I was leaving, right after, there was about, I started at 9:30, it was dark, and how do I leave, how do I get out of the factory so he doesn't see me? So what I did, I took a risk. I didn't know what was happening, what would happen, but I took a risk. And I started walking very slowly so that the apples in my pants won't show up very, very distinctly. I started walking, and very slowly I walked out of the resort, and the guy looks at me and doesn't see anything. So I did it once and twice. And when I remember when I first brought the apple to my father, he was sick. So he took that apple into his hands. He looked at the apple like he didn't believe his eyes. And he said, he made the bracha. He didn't eat it yet. He said, Baruch atah Hashem Elokeinu melech olam, borei pri ha'etz. And he shakes his head like that. And then he takes the apple and starts eating it. And so now, later, sometime afterwards, I realized that the guard knew that I was taking all the apples. Mm-hmm. I was stealing. But he didn't say anything. He knew. He saw. So you never know.
Yes, I just want to say that I'm sorry that all my children couldn't be here and that all my grandchildren can't be here. And I want to mention that Orly is named after her great-grandmother, Aliza, that his Abe's grandmother. And she has three children. Ilana is named after my mother-in-law. Ilana is the because Helena in Greek is a tree, and so Ilana is named after her. Zahara is named after my father, and Khalil the baby is named after my father-in-law, Kalman Shlomo. And also sorry that my daughter-in-law, Eva, is not here. And I'm sorry I'm missing the bold and the beautiful, too.
I would like to ask the children a question, Abraham's children. Do you feel that you were brought up and the light, the dark light, or the light of the experiences of your father during those ages between 39 to 35, did this affect your life in any way?
Well, you haven't talked yet. Do you want to talk?
What do I have to say?
Yeah, I think it had a profound effect on our growing up. It was always in the background. It's kind of like a fish swimming in water. The water was always around you. And I think it caused us to have a tremendous emotional protection around our father because we knew that he was in constant pain, which was expressed in various ways. But we knew underlying it was constant pain, and so anything that we were going through could never measure up to the Holocaust, and that had its own effect. And basically, I think that everything became intensified. Nothing was just what it was. Happiness, you know, having kids became more than having kids. It became having kids, and now we're outdoing Hitler. Getting married became more than getting married. Getting a divorce becomes more than getting a divorce. Every single thing you do has this meaning that links back to the Holocaust. And it's still with us today.
And personally, you? Your
profession? Why I became a psychologist, if that had anything to do with the Holocaust, I'm certain that it did. I think that I was able to connect with a very deep sense of pain that many people, didn't live with. And so one of the things that I do is I specialize in my own private practice, as well as being a professor, I have a private practice too. And I specialize with people who've been sexually abused or victimized in some way, lost a son to gang violence. Things like that, where people have experienced, you know, pain that's beyond the normal realm of experiences. And what's interesting to me is those people actually are very, very interested in the Holocaust. They seem to really resonate with the similar, you know, they feel a camaraderie with Holocaust victims.
Well, I, as the youngest of the children, if at all, felt it, I guess, at least. But, yeah, I assume that it's been possibly, as my older sister has said over here, that you do feel it sometimes. Every so often you might hear a story or something which might leave a dent or a mark somewhere in your mind, which you can refer back to when something, you know, comes back to you. But that's basically it, I think.
Okay, I'm the middle child. how it affected my life. I think I'm not as sensitive as my sister, so I don't think I felt the pain as much. And if I did, it was probably normal to me because that's all I knew. My father is, I know it has affected my father's life and in how he looks at the world, like my sister expressed so nicely. And I just like to tell a story if I can, because what I've learned from it was... Well, it helped me identify with the struggle of the Jewish people throughout the millennium. And a story comes to my mind that I'd like to share with everybody about a Jewish man who wanted to cook a lobster for his friend who wasn't Jewish, a goy, came over, and he wanted to cook him a lobster. So he takes a pot, and he boils water, and he takes the lobster, and he puts it into the boiling water. And the lobster, feeling the boiling water, jumps out, and all over the kitchen counters is dancing around, and the Jew is screaming, "Help, help," and the goy comes running in and says, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm trying to cook you lobster." And the goy says, "That's not how you cook a lobster." And he takes the pot of water, and he pours out the boiling water, and he puts in cold water. And then he takes the lobster, and he puts it into the cold water, and he puts a fire on. And he says that slowly the water will get hotter and hotter. And the lobster, feeling the cold water, is very happy. And as the water gets hotter and hotter, the lobster says, "Well, the water is hotter, but, you know, it was once cold before, so it's probably just going to get cold again." And he doesn't realize that it's getting hotter and hotter until it's too late and he's already cooked. And that's pretty much, teaches me at least, the story of the Jewish people in the Galut, that it's good for them. They become doctors and lawyers and become government. They get into government positions and everything is fine and dandy and in America, success. And then one day things start getting bad and they say, "Well, it'll pass. 6 months the world will be over," as my father used to tell me that his father would say. "Why give up the factory and my whole future and my career just for what, 6 months long?" And things just keep going on and on until the Jews are cooked, and that's all. And that's why I'm very happy and proud of my father and thankful to my father that he moved us all here to Israel, because this really is our homeland, and I'm very happy here, and I hope that all Jewish people will get out before they get cooked. Simply.
Yeah, I'll add now. Okay. Somebody better hold this, though. As far as it goes. Well, I'll start from where we were left off. I think that obviously is one of the results of the Holocaust, that naturally, again, this is my sister's field, not my field, but people that were made victims and have been victims for thousands of years sometimes come to conclusions that are not totally justified factually. And of course, I agree with my sister that Jews have been victims and Jews must be strong and Jews must have their own state. However, the example of the lobster in the pot, I don't know one lobster that would like to be put inside a pot even if the water was cold. I mean, you know, you can't move around in there. Which is why I think that Jews have to be careful, have to be made aware. As my father said, 2-3 weeks before the war, World War II, before the Nazis invaded Poland, so the writing was on the wall. And Jews have to be aware of the writing on the wall. However, Jews do not have to be paranoid. That is my outlook. Jews must be strong, but Jews must not make their own ghetto that they can't psychologically get out and beyond it. About my experiences from growing up, I think that I actually agree with my sister Tamar. I did not feel the Holocaust experience very strongly or overtly. It was more in the background that I knew that my father went through it. I don't think that I felt it so strong when I was growing up. But then again, I was born 20 years after the Holocaust was over. So I guess my father went through, had a longer healing period than when my older siblings were born. However, it was always there. But what I do agree totally is that I think that also made a lasting impression on my father, that because he went through hell on earth, as we all know, even though we cannot totally understand it, he does in a way belittle other experiences and other sorrow and other suffering of other people, because as my sister Orly said, what can compare with the Holocaust? And I'll bring an example from something totally different, which does not have to do with the Holocaust, but I remember when I was in the army and in basic training, and of course basic training is for the infantry as we all know, is the hardest basic training that the Israeli army has to offer. So I remember my father telling me, you know, "Oh, well, what you're going through, well, that's hard, yeah, I know. But when I was in the officer's course in the Israeli army, I remember that we were lying down on sticks and the water was running under us. And now you're spoiled. Today you have your own pup tents. I mean, well, we didn't have that when we were..." You know, so again, you know, then again, when you were in the Israeli army, we didn't have this, we didn't have Intifada, we didn't have Lebanon, we didn't have a lot of things that we have today. So every generation has their difficult points and has their more easier points. And I think that in a way I see, as I just said, that my father, because of what he went through, does have a tendency to sort of belittle other experiences because I went through the Holocaust. So, but I again say that only rarely did I really feel, usually when my father would be very sad or very angry, then you could sort of see it stronger, the impression of the Holocaust on his personality. But generally I didn't, in everyday life I didn't feel it that much.
I'd like to say something, about something my son just said, how his father said, it wasn't like it was when I was in the Army. When I was in the Army, it was worse. I remember going with one son to visit another son who was in the same base or 3 years later, and looking around and seeing that the pup tents now were Srifim huts, and I think they had running water, and I think they had heating in there, and him saying, what is this, a Bet Avra? You know. So I guess it's where you're sitting.
No, it always happens. It's always somebody who's older says that it's, you know, the good old days, and the good old days, or the hard old days, as it may be.
Well,
I'm just
walk 12 miles in the snow to get to school.
Yeah, one of the things I want to say is that I think that the Holocaust affected you much more than you realize. I think it's affecting you at this very moment in your life, and I think it always doesn't come with a sign saying, this is the Holocaust, and this is why you're feeling what you're feeling, and this is why your family's reacting the way that you're reacting. It expresses itself in a variety of ways. And I don't know how much more detail I should get into than that. The other thing is that in terms of minimizing experiences, and that's a very common traumatic response that, you know, when somebody's been through a trauma like the Holocaust, that's something that, you know, sometimes can never be healed. It's so intense, especially without treatment. And, and
like the two psychologists.
How much do you take?
And, you know, one of the things is, you know, when you've been through a trauma like that, oftentimes anything that is similar to that, anything that reminds you, let's say you heard my father say, you know, the thing that he learned the most was that you must sacrifice for your family. So anything that looks similar to that is going to re-trigger the Holocaust experiences. Anything that resonates at anything similar during those years re-triggers those experiences and that pain, and it gets generated, you know, in ripples through the family, and we all feel it, even though it's not carrying a sign that says, this is from the Holocaust.
Can I go for the treatment instead of him?
Very good.
And that'll be $25, please.
Thank you very much, all of you, for being here. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.